Okay guys, we are going live, right? Today we are really happy to have Aaron. Aaron has a very interesting background. Started off as a VC, and now he is actually running his own startup, a very successful one, profitable already.
Certain parts of the business, yes.
Yes, okay, all right. So what I'll do is that I will just hand over to Aaron to just talk a little bit about himself,
yeah,
and then his business, and maybe if we have time, we have just a bit of questioning.
Sure.
All right. Okay. Great.
All right,
Aaron.
Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, Chuck, for having me today. How should we do this? Like, cameras?
Yeah. You're right. Perfect.
Right. That's great. So, my name is Aaron. Started my first company when I was 13. By the time I was 20, I sold a couple of companies already. In between now and then, I basically stupidly took an idea scholarship, ended up at Carnegie Mellon. Did my undergrad, my postgrad, I came back, and then I was actually luckily put into a venture fund, right? So actually, one of my first projects in that fund was to start Box 71, right? In fact, I helped name Box 71, Box 71 when I first came back, and that was basically what I was trying to, what I was doing in Innov8, apart from investing and stuff like that. I was actually looking after the space, you know, helping Chen San and stuff like that to really launch Box 71 into a startup ecosystem, right? So I was with the fund for 5 years, you know, largely doing investments, supporting Southeast Asia investments. Subsequently, I was sent to San Francisco. I started Block 21 in San Francisco for them as well, right? In fact, I started the office there in San Francisco for the fund, right? I came back after a couple of years, and then I was looking after APAC for the fund again. And I left the fund late 2015 to start Carro, right? And basically, Carro, we are a marketplace for cars, right? So it is not so straightforward in the sense that we are not just a marketplace for cars. We do everything from C2C, C2B, B2B, right? We have SaaS platforms that we actually provide to dealers. We have all kinds of things in a marketplace that allows us to buy and sell cars. By and large, I would dare say also today that we are the largest wholesale marketplace for cars, right? In Southeast Asia, we today supply a lot of cars, hundreds of cars a day goes out from us to the dealers, right? So once the car goes out to the dealers is financing to buy the cars, right? And that's again where we make more money, right? Which is the financing part of the business. So I think more than a year ago right now, a year ago today, we managed to recruit Helen, who used to be an ex-MD of Maybank. Very lucky to have her, right? So basically she launched our financing business for us. It allows us very quickly to move into high purchase financing. We move very quickly then into insurance, into warranties, into all kinds of verticals within financing, right? And again, today that product is very much fleshed out. You know, every month we underwrite more than $10 million of loans in aggregate, making us, highly profitable, at least in that side of the business, right? Today, you know, we are working on after sales, right? So you know, as a business, it's very simple, right? Think of us as a marketplace. As we move along, we started to monetize and move stronger and deeper into financial products. Right, everything from insurance to loans to warranties. And now we are actually looking into after sales, right, to complete the whole cycle. At the end of the day, Carro is a total automotive marketplace solution. Right? That's how we look at ourselves. And at the same time, we look at ourselves as a platform that the user can buy, sell cars and stuff like that, so that they have a positive experience as they are buying a car throughout their entire journey. Right? So it's not just buying and selling, but when you're researching for the cars, when you're trying to understand the pricing of the vehicles, when you're trying to get a loan, insurance, warranty, and effectively when your car breaks up, right, who's going to help you? We can, right? And that company today, we are very lucky as well, a Series B company now. We have raised more than $50 million in capital, about 20, 30 bucks in equity, another 20, 30 mil in finance, basically in debt, right, that we take on the company. So our last investor is actually SoftBank. Right, and then of course with participation from Singtel, our largest shareholders, people group, right? But yeah, so that basically is where we are today, right? We're very lucky that all this happened in the last 1 year, 10 months or so, and we'll just share a chart and really just started this, and along the way it has been quite good, right? And it was a blessing because I have been on the other side of the table, as Chuck was saying, being in venture for 5 years helped, right? Now, on the other side, it's great because I basically now negotiate against my previous party, right? But yeah, so I don't know how this works. So do I stop here and then I wait for questions, or how does it work? I don't know.
Yeah. Any questions? Aaron, what made you want to start your business?
Yeah, so I, you know, when I was 13 years old, there was a, it was basically Yahoo, right? Or for that matter, even it wasn't even Yahoo, it was AltaVista, right? Most people wouldn't even know or heard of AltaVista, X-Site, right? Even Netscape, most people my age wouldn't even know of that. So when I was young, when I was 13, the best thing my mom did for me was to get me the internet. By the time I was 11 or 12, I had internet access, which was rare at that point in time. We were talking about 40 kbps, Signet was still around, right? You know, so that period of time, I was very curious, right? So I went online and I see, oh, this is search engine. So I was always wondered how it was built, right? So I went to the local library. And again, that was something that the government did properly, which is setting up the NLP and stuff. I ended up going to libraries a lot, you know, pretty much reading all the computing books that you can imagine at the point in time. So very, very versed in everything from HTML to CGI, which is Perl, right? One of the earliest web languages in the main. Also at the same time, ASP, way before the .NET versions, right? So that was how I got my hands inkling on that. If you ask me really what motivated me to start my own company, it was a very, very simple fact that honestly I made quite a bit of money when I was really young. Right? So by the time I was in my teens, you know, early teens, I was making like tens of thousands a month. Why? Because every website I could charge at that point in time, again, dot com boom days, oh my god, it's just a simple web page and stuff like that. I can charge like $5,000, $10,000 and stuff like that. You know what? I get paid by Western Union. Right, so those days the bank account wasn't that, I mean it was sophisticated enough to receive wire, but it takes a long time to clear checks. Right? I still remember my checks at that point in time, it takes 4 to 6 weeks to clear, which is ridiculous. Because a lot of my clients, all my clients are from the United States. Right? And that's when I started to build up you know, a sizable team, right, doing system integration. Not less system integration, but more pure development work. Right? You know, and that led to starting my first company, which was a hosting company, right? Web hosting and stuff like that. One host subsequently sold to an Aussie company that was trying to diversify. And then I moved deeper into ad tech, right, and stuff like that. So what prompted me to start my own company was really because of the fact that I was very interested, you know, inquisitive about how and what went behind all this search engine at the point in time. And that was what prompted me to start my first company.
So now I remember, yes, sir. Right, you won the IT Youth Award.
That's right.
As you explained now, I remember precisely when you presented, you know,
right.
you had quite a number of clients which were
a lot,
right? Not in Singapore, right?
In fact,
your web client,
yeah.
Right?
In fact, most of them were foreigners, except for one or two local big boys. Yeah.
And you were working with developers in
all over the world,
Ukraine.
That's right. Yeah, Ukraine. You know, India, even especially European cities, they have a lot of good talent, right? But they unfortunately don't get paid much. So good thing is that I've accessed all these talents. At the point in time, again, not so much competition, barely any startups around, right? So it was those are good days. Yeah, exactly right.
So I mean, I read, you know, you actually saw a gap,
yeah.
Right? In how did you come about identifying that gap in your current business?
Yeah, I mean, for the current business, it was quite straightforward. You know, I was basically towards the end of my bond. So what happened was that I was looking for things to do, right? So I was already towards the end of my bond, maybe half a year, right? I was thinking, okay, my time is up with the government, so I should live, right? So then what should I do? So I asked myself that, you know, and I thought deep about that, and I came up with only two solutions, basically what I was interested in, right? So I thought, okay, I'm interested in properties, and I'm interested in vehicles, or basically cars itself, right? So I was very clear that I want to do something in this two space. So then that was where I went. So I went straight into both of these verticals. I did dive into property. That was really the first inclination, but you know, that was when I realized that Darius was in, Steve was there, you know, so many people were doing property part of stuff here. The market wasn't also really right, right? In the sense that what actually happened back in 2015 was that, you know, you see, again, I was in the United States, right, just for context. Trulia, Zillow, you know, Redfin was the most advanced guy and stuff like that. But even that, there was very little momentum in that space. Versus when I was looking at companies like Remensher, Hotshot View, right, the early days TUC companies, Drive Shift, and I was in the United States. I actually met Remensher and stuff in China as well. The momentum was superb, right? So that was really what prompted me to look deeper into that space. And the gap that we identified at the start was basically direct order buying and selling, right? Because ultimately we want to buy a car, but at the same time as a direct owner, you're very afraid constantly about buying lemons, right, getting the wrong vehicle. It's a huge investment, especially in this part of the world, right? The other thing is that what stunned me and made me want to get into the space was the sheer fact of the growth opportunity. You look into Indonesia, right? The penetration for cars is like what, 2-3% per household, right? Per thousand household. So you can imagine the growth potential, right? At a steady state, you're talking about 80%, 70% penetration, right? So you can only imagine with more roads, with more middle income people moving up the stack, that should only prompt for more aspirational purchases like vehicles or properties, right? So I do think fundamentally today still the both spaces are great. Vietnam, Indonesia, Thailand, right, are great places, and that's how we look into the opportunity. I guess to answer your question point blank, first of all, I look into what I'm interested in. Number two, let's go straight and find an issue, right, based on the vertical.
So from that perspective, I actually gather, right, that your stint in the Valley really, really helped.
That's right.
Right, I mean, and with the combination of actually working for a VC,
that's right,
you get access to a lot of ideas that you already understand what are the mechanics, right? So does it mean that someone has to work before they start their business?
I have this debate.
Your first business you didn't, right? I mean you were in school.
Literally. I did, that's right.
Right?
There's also a natural cap on how big a business could be, right? Which is why I didn't see how big a business could be, right? When I first saw my company, it was like $1 or $2, right? So it wasn't like a big exit. But also a good exit, it was good from the standpoint that, if I really raise venture funding, ultimately I have to get a portion of, even if I exit $100, I maybe get 10, which is about the same, right? In that sense. But to put things in perspective, do I have to work to start a company? The answer is no. If you look at so many of them, like Carousel guys and stuff like that, they really never work outside of internship before for the Carousel. And Carousel is very popular today still, right? And if you look into many other comparables and stuff, they all, I would say that you don't really have to work in order to start something. But one thing for sure, my days in the Valley, right, in the United States, even in China as I was looking after some investors there and stuff like that, I think the most useful things as a venture fund, right, was the fact that we get to partake in board meetings, right? The very fact that we partake in board meetings, we actively roll our sleeves to help a popular company scale higher, especially in the US when we were there, we do everything from even helping them choose bankers, right, before they IPO a company. How many guys my age, at the point in time I was 20 something, right, would be able to sit in a room, right, look into all these things, S1 filings, right, how to get a company IPO'd, looking at how a company scaled, right? I think that benefit from working in a venture fund has been super helpful, right? Being able to see things from 0 to 100, 0 to 300, 0 to 1,000, right? As you were mentioning, how you perform the subcommittee and stuff. Having insights into that is just invaluable. Yeah.
How did you, I'm Joe, by the way.
Yes.
You're talking about identifying a gap.
Sure.
Right? In 2015, I mean, it's not, when you say gap, how do you define a gap as in like, there are already players, obviously, in that space,
sure,
right? So how big a gap still qualifies as a gap for you in your mind?
Right. So to be honest, when we were looking at the market, we didn't think that there was anybody in the market.
Okay.
Right. That was how we were looking at it. Because the closest guys to us would be companies like SPH-owned SG Karma, for instance, right? And that really is a classified as a model. You look at ourselves really as a transactional marketplace. You don't buy a single car from SG Karma. You go to that, go to SG Karma browse, and you call. Right. And you buy from someone else effectively. But on Carro, it's a little different in the sense that you actually buy from us. Right? And I can dare say that we're one, if not the earliest guys that actually push in C2C. Right? Direct owner cars, buying, selling and stuff like that. And for that matter, providing a transactional platform where you can come in straight away, everything is done for you, right? Buying a car, checking an inspection, the paperwork, the warranty, the insurance and stuff like that. Everything is done nicely for you, you don't have to worry about it. Just find a car that you like, buy it. Literally. So that was the first experience that we were targeting. Now, truth of the matter is this, the direct owner like, marketplace part of stuff is only in Singapore maybe less than 15%, right? 10-15% of the market statistically. So is it a huge business? Well, annually, let's just talk about auto loan industry, it's about 10 billion, right? Just in Singapore. So is this a huge business? I don't know. Even at 10% of the market, still a 1B business, right? And that's not even including the trading of the sometimes I get this question a lot, right, which is the VCs will be asking, how big is this market? Right? The truth of the matter is, how big depends on how much we want to drill in. Right? You know, for us today, we sold the vision that we'll be doing a lot more than just buying and selling cars. And I'm glad to say that, you know, after 1.5 years of executing, we have been doing that. Right? We today are doing way more than just a marketplace. Right? We're way more than just buying and selling platform. We are financial. We are an agency. We provide underwriting for warranties. We also do after sales, tow truck stuff, and things like that.
Right.
Yeah. So for that matter, it is not a small space at all, because everyone knows the automotive industry is $1 trillion industry.
How much of that? Now you've got this whole structure and services and all that in place, right? In the first 2 months of what you set up, how much of that was in place or in fact was part of the vision?
So from day zero, this was the concept. From day zero, the whole concept was an ecosystem play, right? And that was how we look at it, right? And from day zero, all my investors, and seed investors will see this, right? We have almost like a pseudo plan, and it's like boxes of boxes. So we have like maybe 50 boxes in there, and these are all systems, right? And how it links and stuff. So this 50 systems was built one by one, and we internally have a dashboard, right? Orange is done, green is doing, green is not yet, right? And you can see that it's starting to become almost orange. That's where we know that we are there. Then if we know that, we just have to improve upon the systems and not build more systems, right? But since day zero, that has been conceptualized.
Okay. So what I'm asking is, like, okay, so day zero, you talk about that push, right? So what is that? What does that day minus 10 look like in terms of what are your, you know, the planning?
So day minus 10 was basically all about speaking to people.
Okay.
Right. Again, as a venture fund, we have unfair access. I can speak to people pretty much. The good thing about Innov8 is that we are seed all the way to peer review. That range of investments basically allows me to speak to anybody I want.
Mm.
Right. So it's all about speaking to people, understanding the market, trying to understand whether or not this business makes sense at all. Right. And after a certain level of speaking to people, bouncing off ideas and stuff like that, then it's down to HR. It's really down to that. It's forming a team. Right. So day minus 10 will be talking to people, making sure that everything is somewhat okay. Right. You
right.
don't have to have it fully fleshed out, control of the method is you or not. Every along the way, you will always add things. Right. But day minus 1, day minus 2, closer to execution will be all about hiring. Putting the best team together is the most important thing in fundraising. You know, when we fundraise, when we invest, we never once invest. Okay, I can't say it anymore because I just invested in one guy that is a sole founder, but it's rare, right? It's
okay.
Really, really rare. I have a portfolio of more than 20, 30 companies, right? You know, one out of the biggest deals that I give, right? Maybe 3% or less of the investments. Venture funds do not like to invest in sole founders. Yeah. So anyhow, if you ask me day minus 10, minus 20, talk to people, figure out who you want to join your team, get some money, run a business.
When does the burning of cash start?
When does the burning of cash start?
On that
starts?
Timeline.
For ourselves, it starts on day 30. That's very honestly, right? Because day 30 is when you start paying salary after the first month, right? So that was when we started burning of cash. But we have been very, very conservative. I mean, you know, we look at our numbers, and annually we transact more than $200 million worth, right now. Are we profitable? Certain parts of the business are super profitable, right? But of course, we are still slightly underburning. I mean, do I want to be profitable? We can, right? Tomorrow, if I like to, we can turn on part of the business and straight away become green, right? Our burn rate publicly is known as, you know, $50,000-$60,000 a month. It's nothing. Yeah. So we have quite a bit of cash reserves. So in fact, our investors are saying, so why do you need so much cash? Yeah, but we need it because we want to expand quickly, right? Not just in Singapore, around Indonesia and Thailand as well, which we are already present.
How much of your business is in your physical place? Like, is all of it in the cloud?
Yeah. So I would say that depending on the various subsection of the business, right? So for Carro itself, if it's trading of the vehicles itself, unfortunately, it is very much offline, right? What we do is we form a layer of tech, right? So everything that we can do to introduce efficiency, time, lowering time commitment, etc. We'll do to allow our salesmen to sell faster, more efficiently, right? Stuff like that. So how much of those is in the cloud? I would say apart from the meeting of people, doing the test drives itself, everything of this on the cloud, right? Transactional stuff, taking up pictures, OCR, the ICs and stuff like that, right? That much of this. For Genie itself, which is a financing co, most of it, right, would say 80%, right? There's always that 10-20% that we can't do away with because of not even our issues. It's like, for instance, the banks refuse to adopt e-signatures, for instance, right? We just have to have it signed physically because it's under the Act, right? The Higher Purchase Act, that you have to have a physical doc signed, etc. Yeah. So there's still parts of it that we can't do much.
That's actually very interesting. So I think if I distill everything, right, there are maybe two or three or four points that really are the key. Like one is you actually did quite a lot of research,
mm-hmm.
right, in terms of
the business.
The other one is actually forming the team.
That's right.
Right, team is a critical one. So the third one, I think, is to have some startup capital,
mm-hmm.
right? So where did you get your first startup capital? Is it your own savings or you went?
Okay, again, we are very lucky because having been in this line, I know exactly where the money is. So I think our fundraise was done in a day, right? My first raise was 1 mil, right? And then it was done in a day, 4 people, that's it, right? A quarter mil each. And it was quite straightforward.
Okay.
I'm rare, and for that matter, lucky, right? Because I know exactly who does what kind of investments, for that matter, what the check sizes, you know? And again, because a lot of times, since we know all these guys well enough, it's a relationship, mm-hmm. right? Like for now, right now, if I ask Chuck for money, he might invest a little bit if I would start the business, right?
Sure.
It's a bit different. Yeah. Yeah.
Absolutely right. Cool. Any question?
Sorry, I'm recommended by Kenny.
Sure. Just ask.
I'm totally not a tech person.
No problem.
Okay,
yeah,
okay.
Happy to help.
But
in
I'm
person.
Very interested.
Thank
to
you.
Know
yeah.
about it.
That's right.
Yeah. So, would you
Yeah, so today we are in Indonesia and Thailand. To be very honest, again, we have no immediate plans to move out to, say, Vietnam or even Philippines and stuff like that. Primarily because I look at it as 做生不如做熟, right? So in a sense that I need to know the market and understand.
So
market.
Africa is
Africa is not out. It's just a matter of time, right? I like my market. I go and study the market from time to time, right?
Because why I'm asking?
It's a great export market.
I recently met a few people.
Yeah.
They were from North Africa.
Yeah.
They are like desperate trying to buy
cars,
parts. Spare parts.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, their mentality, they prefer European cars, Mercedes, Audi, things like that. And also, they were like, but a lot of obstacles. Firstly, very difficult for them to travel.
Yeah.
Secondly, very difficult to get people to trust them. And also their own rules and regulations. Yeah. But on the other hand, it's a big market.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, it
so
is.
I was
so for us, we look at it as call centers, right? To be fair, we actually today export cars to Kenya as well, for instance, right? So those are some of segments are our customers, but we don't export a whole bunch of them to them yet. It's just not focused that way. I mean, again, this has more to do with two things, right? First of all, the familiarity of the geography itself, right? I'm way more familiar in Bangkok and I mean in Indonesia and Thailand versus Nairobi, you know, Cape Town and stuff like that. So I prefer to focus on these two entities first. Second thing is actually a lot to do with the investors, right? So depending on who you take money from, like again, look, our largest backer is actually Lippo, right? Which is one of the largest family in Indonesia, right? So again, we are very lucky. We have certain family groups in Thailand, for instance. You know, so banks more agnostic, they don't care, right? But regardless, they are more interested in certain geographies. It's very clear, right? You know, agenda is largely Southeast Asia, right? And for that matter, it's going to be very hard for me to push. Say, for instance, tomorrow I go to the board and say, oh, I want to go to Kenya. They'll be like, you must be out of your mind. A, B, cannot. Right? Yeah. So that's typically how it works, at least in the board. So I wouldn't even harbor that thought until such time that we are ready. And by ready, it means we are somewhat off scale in Indonesia, Thailand, and opening up certain places like Nairobi, or for that matter, Africa, or even Japan, which we keep a very close tab on, UK as well, can be potential markets, right? And that's when we are ready to expand upwards, right? But for now, no immediate plans, right? But three cities is enough to kill us.
Yes.
Yeah. It's not easy given that we're still fairly small, right? It's about 60 plus people today.
That's interesting. We were discussing about manpower before this, right? I went to a meeting and you know, very experienced individual explained to me that he started to work for a startup.
That's right.
And then he couldn't adapt to the startup because the environment is actually very different between the startup, the SME, and MNCs. Mm. Right now, if you come from an MNC, you go to a startup, it's a complete, I put in quotation mark, chaos.
That's right.
Right, because the startup grow from zero to whatever it is in a relatively short time.
Right.
Versus an MNC that has been there for 50, 60, 100 years, you know, right? So what would you, right, be looking at really getting experience hired into your organization to help you with your process?
Yeah.
And what would be the advice you give to the guys, right, from the mindset standpoint,
right,
coming to your organization?
I mean, today we are already doing it. In fact, 1 year ago, we have already started embarking on that, right? So we were also quite lucky because what we had was a few guys that came from large enterprise. The good thing also is a good part, maybe actually all my top management are previously scholars, so we would have worked in Experience, SAS, or any of the large enterprise you can think of, we would then, right? Facebook, Google, etc. So processes to us is not new, right? So we were not starting a company like a bunch of young grads, you know, like, oh, let's start a company and stuff. We were honestly a little bit more experienced, which was great. So we started a company with our eyes open, knowing exactly what to do. So 1 year ago, we started our first very senior hire, right, which was this lady from Maybank, right? She was, I mean, superb, right? Again, one of my best career bets was to bring someone like her on board, right? I give her, for example, right? So I mean, her name is Helen, right? So she used to be a very senior lady in the bank. So I know her for more than a year before, and rather I persuaded her to join for more than a year before she eventually, you know, jumped over. But long story short, or zero experience, how are we going to do that? Then the whole experience about lending, right? Again, you know, we can say that my guys are from experience, SaaS, we know how to do data science. So trust me, right? We're from CMU, so we know exactly how it works on machine learning and stuff like that. But I can tell you half the time it's nonsense, right? Because the truth of the matter is we don't have much information. How are we going to let the machine learn, right? So there's just no way we can backtest all these things unless we are banking ourselves, right? So the good thing again, we have someone like Helen, which is then able to come in to provide what we call expert opinions and build a model around her expertise, right? So things like that are superb. Now, was there issues initially to work together? The answer is honestly yes, right? She's of course a lot older than us, right? In fact, she's double or almost double my. She might listen to this, so I better not say anything. So it was honestly a little bit bumpy as we start, because as she was trying to adapt, right, coming from a corporate, you know, no PA suddenly, right, you know, from a room to a co-working desk and stuff like that in our office, which was an open office right now. So it wasn't easy, right, for her to also come on board and stuff like that. So there's a period of adaptation, right? So I guess to answer the question, are we looking to bring, I mean, for sure, right, you know, we have brought on many people from the industry, you know, 40, 50,
so how do you iron out all these bumps, you know?
Yeah, so how do we iron out all these bumps is basically like give free rein as much as we can, right? So at least for myself, that was how I approached it. Just before I came for this meeting, I also brought someone from the after sales part of the business, right? So he has been in after sales for more than 15, 20 years. So he was writing, if you don't know why, but randomly he just wrote me an email today and said thank you for all the trust and free rein, right, for letting me run the business. Because I really don't care, I mean, not don't care. I don't break down the neck, right, on telling you, oh, this is the wrong way of doing it and stuff like that. So that's how I look at it. I think for us, we run it differently in the sense that, again, we were very lucky, right, because these are all new businesses, right? So what I did was that Helen, for instance, ran the financing business. So she came in, straight away, she runs it her way. Her way really is fine, right? And then I come in and I'm like a tech vendor, if you mean, right? So my a little bit look at Carro is like, yeah, freaking much SI with a lot of developers. More than half my manpower is developers, right? Are developers. So I basically let them run a business a certain time, right? Maybe 2-3 months. And then I come in and I say, Helen, where can we help? How can we improve the process and make this business bigger, right? And then, of course, if to begin with, she doesn't buy into all this IT, you know, stuff, then we have a problem, right? But of course, before we brought them in, they already are sold with the fact that businesses today needs to change, right? To adapt to the digital economy and stuff like that, the way things are needed. Done will change entirely. You know, even public transportation today, who would expect, you know, the state where comfort is today, for instance, right? So businesses need to change as much as the people. So for them, whoever that joins us needs to realize that fact. And who do we hire? People like that, right? People who have been in the industry forefront, people who understand, realize the change and want to join something, those people are more than glad to hire. And you know, to answer the question, how do we smoothen all this bump is really have some free rein for a period of time, right? You know, try to understand and work with each other for a good few months, and then we go in to fix the other problems, right? I think a lot of times we don't let the situation play itself out, right? And then we just jump to conclusions too. For instance, my guys will be like, "Oh, that's so old school, right? That is like, what the hell? This guy is doing this and that and stuff like that," which is a problem itself, right? So my initial take has always been, you guys run the business the way you do, right? I'm just here to help. My job really as a CEO is really to just facilitate, and really raise money. That's all I do. I don't have any operations KPI. Yeah. So that's
what. That's very important, because I'm currently in a transition. I've been working with all MNCs. Most recently is the Disney. Just like
this. Okay.
Yeah. I worked there for 5 years. And I joined Disney 5 years ago. At the time, they had 5 lines of businesses. And my boss's line is the TV, Disney Channels, was one of the biggest of 7 TV globe. 5 years later,
right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so I wrote to the head based in Hong Kong, and he knew me. He said, okay, I will highly refer you, because I knew if I threw the normal way to apply, get my CV. This is also Kenny told me, if we have network, you must use your network. Yeah, so, but the HR people did warn me, say, hey, the salary you cannot expect too high, you could slash quite a bit. I said, come on, at my age now, I'm willing to be a receptionist at Disney office, so salary is not a top priority. He said, okay, then I wrote to the VP based in Hong Kong, the VP replied to the team here, say, gave her a chance, but no news, no news. Uh-huh. The HR also said, oh, we got your CV, no news. So I called the person who is in charge of the team here. She said, you are way too qualified. I said, too experienced. That's my right. role is very, very junior. Then I said, I'm willing to learn from the beginning. Don't worry about the budget. He said, no, I would like to give a chance to a fresh and green.
Yeah.
So we can groom this person into a salesperson.
Yeah.
So it's like a
I fully understand that, you know, in fact, yeah, having this conversation with Chuck earlier on about this group of people, as you correctly mentioned, right? Basically reskilling and stuff like that. I mean, from a company standpoint, sometimes when we look at hiring, for instance, for a certain position, you're right? So, you know, there's always this issues. Like, I give you a real example, like, just myself, my head of finance just asked me for a position that he wants to fill, right? And I asked him, so who's this that you're trying to bring? And then say, oh, there's this guy that is like 50 plus years old and stuff like that. I said, that's fine, right? And then the first question he had for me was that, do you think it's okay? I said, look, I don't really care. As long as at the end of the day, he or she can fit into the business, right? So I think, to me, yes,
it also depends on the nature of the job.
That's right. Yeah. So the nature of that job was fairly administrative. Yeah. So to me, you know, I should think that unfortunately you have to then look for a job that suits more, right? Of your skill sets and stuff, and then maybe less the sales.
I checked on the JD, and I thought I had a
good
lot
shot.
Of class,
sure.
Because I knew the company,
sure.
from head to toe, and the team. Three of them all outsiders, one from Hong Kong, the other two hired from outside, because Disney's culture quite difficult to work there. So I thought I'm immediately available and I'm willing to lower my salary. And
so should have given you a chance.
But my daughter told me very frankly, mommy, you are empty. You are empty, but you say you don't take it in a bad
negative
way.
Manner,
and things are expensive.
That's right.
And not many people can afford.
Sure.
And only the people can see the value. So I said, if I go work for startups, he said, depends on the boss. Because startups are all very young.
Yeah.
Yeah. I look at my son and say, oh, I'm about all your age.
Yeah.
So the way he talked to me, and you know, always I talk to him like 10 sentences, he only replied with one word.
Okay.
So I message him, where are you? Outside. I said, I know you're outside. Where are you? It's like, you know, so that's why I have a potential plan, employer who is a startup also.
Sure. That's good.
That's why Kenny pushed me to come to, you know, this talk to listen. I like to know the mentalities and all that. I'm quite worried about the young people, and then you ask, oh, it's like they all,
all I can say is, at least on my side of the business, the guys that work for us, I mean, increasingly we have a lot more, right? Average age 40 and stuff like that, haven't had any complaints, right? In a sense, at least the guys that we bring on board, the 20-ish, if their attitude wasn't correct, if they're going to laugh at people's age and stuff, then it wouldn't have even been a cut. Yeah.
Yeah.
So depending on the startup, really, right? But ultimately, I think you'll be fine. Yeah.
Mr. Chuck is right. You know, the MNC culture, whatever culture, is very different. MNC is like, it's so structured. Everything you follow. Disney like that, the policy is like too comfortable, you just do your work. Whereas in startups, a lot of things like the fluid, maybe you can, you know, talk to the boss and all that. It's like a small family. Good part is like no politics, no money. You know, big corporations, work is easy, play
used to be from Singtel. Yeah. That's small as well, right? You know, and talk about politics is.
Yeah, that's the heavy part.
Just in terms of in terms of psychology or in terms of how your organization works, right? How many of your team are entrepreneurs?
I don't necessarily think of it that way, but the interesting question, because the way I run the business is exactly that, right? It's just the other day I was sharing with this investor saying that what exactly you are doing with Carro, right? There's so many businesses. I haven't seen a startup like this before. I say I run it like a company of entrepreneurs. Mm. Right? So I look at Helen herself as an entrepreneur, right? Because she runs the business without my input at all, right? You know, at the start. Right now, now that we over time, after the business is set up, established, we then come in and then we synergize and aggregate the whole mother group together. Similarly for Gary, right? Similarly for Aditya, for what? I think naturally, the folks who join a startup and want to grow that startup are entrepreneurs themselves, right? So if you ask me how many people we have in our team are entrepreneurs, I can say, I guess, that everybody is interested in making a company successful, or for that matter, better. And if given that to me is enough as an entrepreneur, right? They have taken a step, or for that matter, taken a chance, right, to join a company like this young, right? You are only 1.5 years old, or 1 year, 10 months old, right? And for that matter, again, you know, come in and then take a chance and then grow with us. I think that itself is a very courageous act. And for that matter, we don't look at them that way, oh, this guy's an entrepreneur, that guy's not, right? We look at all of them as having taken that chance. Everyone wants to make it happen. Everybody is for that matter an entrepreneur, right? It's not just the CEO who is, right? There's everybody else that works with them. Yeah.
Do you believe that they said entrepreneurs, you must have the guts, you have a very good sense of seeking opportunities. Actually, you don't need to have a lot of degrees.
Yeah.
Because the more like a master
the
degree,
more you learn,
doctor degree, the more you get knocked.
I guess this question is more about education versus starting up, right? So for that matter, it is true, right? In the sense that the more you study, your opportunity cost is higher. So the inclination to start something or
they,
the risk,
they worry more.
Reward profile doesn't make sense.
Right?
Because
worry
if I have a PhD,
more.
Why not go do something else, right? Yes, I fully agree on that part of business. But you know, if the question is more about whether or not we think if you study more, you'll be more successful. My answer is probably no. Everybody else knows that Bill Gates, Steve Jobs and stuff like that, he didn't even, Mark Zuckerberg didn't really complete their degrees, right? He's still out fine. For myself, I guess by default, since I took a scholarship, my grades were not too bad, right? Mm-hmm. So as a result, we were fine. Academically, I'm okay, right? But the truth of the matter is this, have I applied anything that I learned in school, point blank from the screens in the United States and stuff like that? Answer is probably no, right? It's, everything is more about what you learn outside school, right? Today, you know, I when I was in CMU, the good thing is that the US, the schools are very liberal by nature, which basically means that you can do anything, right? I learned golf, I learned baking, right? On top of that, I learned robotics. Till today, still serving very well, right? I learned everything from, one of my key projects when I was in CMU was to do virtualization. Just yesterday, I spoke to some Temasek guys that was looking to do investment. What do you think about this space? I happen to do an undergrad on that, right? So, and those things you don't learn in school, I mean, in classes and all, but it's always that things that you learn outside school, mm-hmm. and more importantly, actually, the friends you make outside school.
Networking.
The network itself mm-hmm. is everything, right? So, especially in this part of the world, the number of times I've called my classmates, I need help, I need a favor in the ministry, or in the corporate, in any of the large startups, we will have someone in there. And that's why in school it's all about that, right? It's about building that network of friends.
I think it's a habit as well. I mean, this thing about asking, right? I've noticed, like, you think about the asking thing as a very normal thing, you just call it friends or whatever it is. I don't think many people ask.
Yeah, that's true. So most people, like, don't want to, like, you know, embarrassing, like I say, you know, your support, right? It's
totally true.
Yeah.
I mean, how I get to know Joe was, I got his number, I called him, he picked up the phone,
yeah.
And he said, let's have prata.
There is a research shows results. What kind of people will be successful?
Yeah, really.
IQ is bonus, right?
Sure.
If you want high IQ, is high. But high IQ with very low EQ,
yeah.
Definitely
doesn't work as well.
There are plenty of those. There are plenty of those around. Yeah. gaming scene, but he knows 90% of the students. So all these are networks.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, especially for him, because his father is a very famous politician.
Yeah, but himself, he is a very down-to-earth guy. He, of course, he is not very eloquent and all that. Yeah. So you compare with Donald Trump, low EQ, low IQ, and also...
He still got there, because he got very high money.
But I believe he is also quite a guy, though, otherwise he won't be able to make so much money.
That's right. I mean, he's definitely not stupid.
Yeah, not stupid, but his way of doing things is not like by the book one.
That's
so
right.
Nobody knows what's his next step. Probably this is a strategy as well. Nobody knows.
Great. I think we've come to a close because the question that came from online was that your face was getting blurred because it's out of focus. So I think what we'll do is that we'll close. Aaron, thank you very much.